members of Malaysia's Urology Association and experts in renal transplantation, structural reconstructions, and he also an excellent robotic surgeon. Mr. Morales sits on the Malaysian Sport Urology as examiner and affiliated with Masha Medical College. And we would like to hear your speech for today. Thank you very much.
Yeah. Thank you, Madam Chairman. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. So, the famous British urologist by the name of Roger Kirby, in his opening chapter in his book, Trauma to the Genital Urinary Tract in 1977, wrote, "The ureter, like a jealous lover, if slighted or ignored, may wreak a terrible revenge." And this is true today for urologists who deal with this kind of iatrogenic trauma. This is our experience also. So my presentation for today will focus on these topics: the anatomy of urological injuries, how to prevent them. Primary prevention means preoperatively, secondary prevention means intraoperatively, and tertiary prevention means postoperatively. We'll also look at the management of these injuries, whether they present early or delayed, and maybe at the end of the presentation I'll give you a few cases that we have managed. Anatomy of ureteric injuries. The first point to note is that the incidence of urinary tract injuries in gynecological surgery is low, varying from vaginal hysterectomy 0.2%, abdominal hysterectomy 1.3%, and radical hysterectomies, including laparoscopic surgery, 3%. The second point is the majority of these injuries actually seem to occur after uncomplicated hysterectomies. Now, the ureter is divided by the pelvic bone into the upper abdominal ureter and the lower pelvic ureter. So the abdominal ureter runs inframedially over the psoas. Let me see that. Yeah, it runs inframedially over the psoas and crosses the common iliac artery before it disappears into the true pelvis. At this juncture here, it lies posterior to the infundibular pelvic ligament where the ovarian vessels lie. And this is one of the sites of injury. In the true pelvis itself, the ureter here in black, it runs in front of the internal iliac artery, behind the ureter, and heads back towards the ischial spine. It then moves medially and forward in the base of the broad ligament. In the base of the broad ligament, it is crossed at right angles by this uterine artery at the level of the internal pores of the cervix. Now, Hurd et al., looking at CT images, reported that the distance at the internal pores between the cervix and the ureter is just 2.3 centimeters. And this distance decreases with increasing BMI of the patient. And this is another common site of ureteric injury. So the ureter can be damaged in a variety of ways: kinking and ligation by sutures, transection, either complete or partial or complete, cross injuries due to clam injuries, and perhaps the most difficult to recognize intraoperatively is this devascularization or ischemic injury. And this is due to extensive dissection of the ureter or the excessive uses of NED devices, because now we've got so many NED devices. The bladder can be divided, injuries to the bladder can be divided into the anterior lacerations, which are easy to recognize and easy to repair. The posterior lacerations are a little bit more difficult because they tend to extend downwards into the area of the trigone, they may involve the uterine orifices, the vagina, and they may give rise to a post-operative vesical vaginal fistulas. And then, again, there is this occult injuries, again due to devascularization of the bladder and the vagina posteriorly. And this again is due to a lot of energy devices, like a Ligature, ultrasonic, which they use in the back of the bladder. And this can be compounded if, in addition, you have some inadvertent suture placement into the bladder or development between the hematoma between the vagina and the bladder. And these patients, intraoperative, you don't notice anything, but postoperatively, they'll get a late or delayed presentation of a VVF. So let's talk about prevention. Primary prevention just means preoperatively, you identify risk factors that disrupt the normal anatomy and put the ureter at risk of injury. So the common risk factors which you all know will be adhesions, numbers had previous surgery, radiotherapy, endometriosis, patients with large tumors which tend to distort the anatomy, and patients with high BMI. So having identified risk factors, the steps that you should take, the preventive steps would be pre-op CT imaging, so you can plan your operative strategy. A pre-operative consult with your urology and your general surgical colleagues, and a lot of urologists, a lot of gynecologists now ask for prophylactic stenting of the ureters. In terms of urological anomalies, there are some anomalies, both congenital and acquired, which may catch the gynecologist off guard. And I'll give you a few examples. This is cross renal ectopia. That means the right kidney has crossed over and fused with the left. It's a congenital condition. But the ureters still cross over the midline. And because they're not in a normal place where you expect to see the ureters, you may damage them. This, of course, is pelvic kidney. This left kidney lies in the pelvis. And when these kidneys become hypermetropic for some reason, they're easily mistaken as an ovarian cyst on an ultrasound. The IVP on the left here shows a dilated tubular structure, and you get a hint of there being two ureters. So this is the duplex system, complete duplex bilaterally. So even if you identify one ureter, you will miss another ureter damaging. This IVP here on the right is a typical horseshoe kidney. Horseshoe kidney means the lower poles of both kidneys are fused together. So you get this typical horseshoe appearance, U-shaped horseshoe experience. And the ureters in this instance are more medially displaced. This IVP here shows an abnormally small bladder. And those of you from East Malaysia will recognize this as tuberculosis of the bladder. But of course you can get a similar picture in somebody who's had radiotherapy. This is a cystoscopic finding of a common condition, which is endometriosis, and here you have endometriotic deposits in the bladder. So now we come to secondary prevention. Secondary prevention just means intraoperative techniques that you employ to prevent injury in the first place. Secondly, if you're going to cause an injury, you should recognize it early in the operation itself. And the third aspect of secondary prevention is appropriate management of these injuries. So the surgical points to note in secondary prevention is early identification and preservation of the ureters, especially in those common sites of injury which occur at the ovarian pedicle, down here in the uterine artery, and sometimes when you're closing the vagina, if the bladder has not been displaced caudally enough, you can also catch the ureters in the lateral aspect. Adherent bladder, when the bladder is adherent, it is better to use sharp dissection to displace it. So that when you use sharp dissection, if you cause an injury, you recognize it. Whereas in blunt dissection, you push the bladder down, you may inadvertently cause a perforation, you won't notice it. The experience of the surgical team is of course vital, especially most of maybe in laparoscopic cases. And surgeon experience is also important in cases of high volume bleed and judicious use of energy sources. The surgeon experience is really important because an experienced surgeon has a high index of suspicion for neurological injury, and he has a low threshold to institute diagnostic maneuvers intraoperatively to detect these injuries. Some of the visual clues that surgeons use are contusion of the ureter, the color of the ureter, dusky, loss of peristalsis. And of course, if you have clear leak of some clear fluid in the operative field, that's an indication of some urine leak. And of course, blood in the urine tract and in the urine bag may also be a sign that you have damaged the bladder. So the intraoperative maneuvers, the common intraoperative maneuvers that are used, for the bladder, you just simply fill up the bladder with either mucosa or the mucosal bloom and look for a leak. For ureteric damage, the most expeditious way is to perform a cystectomy. Open the bladder anteriorly, find the ureteric orifices, and pass a feeding tube. If the feeding tube goes up, there's very little, there's a small likelihood it will damage anything. If you've got image intensified in your operating theater, most urologists, we would perform cystoscopy, you know, look at the bladder, pass a catheter up the ureteric orifice and do a retrograde pyrogram bilaterally, just to make sure you don't damage anything. This older paper, it's an old paper in 1999 by Gilmore. He looked at eight studies, retrospectively he looked at eight studies which used routine intraoperative cystoscopy during benign gynecological surgery to detect unsuspected injury to the urogenital tract. And so the key take-home points here is that routine intraoperative cystoscopy resulted in a four-fold higher incidence of urological injuries as compared to the standard literature. It also allowed almost 90% of these injuries to be detected early during the operation itself. And of these injuries, about 70% of these early injuries can be managed by simple procedures by the surgeon. For example, removing obstructing sutures or putting a stent. However, management of more extensive ureteric injuries requires a formal surgical repair of the ureter. So in the upper ureter, abdominal ureter, a ureteric repair is usually in the form of an anastomotic ureteroureterostomy. That means the segment of ureter which is non-viable has to be excised. The edges of the ureter has to be mobilized, has to be spatulated, and has to be anastomosed in a tension-free suture, a tension-free manner, using interrupted sutures and usually use a stent to help in healing. However, the pelvic ureter, the distal pelvic ureter, if you get an injury here, that usually mandates a ureteric reimplantation. That means you have to join the ureter back to the bladder. And this is because the distal segment is, the blood supply is usually not good. And to do this, to join the proximal stump back into the bladder usually has to be mobilized upward to make up for the loss of ureteric length. And the techniques that are used to mobilize the bladder, we call it either a psoas hitch or a bony flap. So in a psoas hitch, the bladder is open in a transverse manner. You put your hand in, stretch it up, and you hitch it to the psoas tendon. And then the ureter is then re-implanted back into the bladder. That's called a psoas hitch, and that's usually the simplest procedure that we do. Sometimes, if the ureteric loss is too big for a psoas hitch, then we have to make a bladder flap. We have to fashion a bladder flap that goes up to the proximal stump. That's called a bony flap. For both these kind of procedures, a bony flap or a psoas hitch, you have to have a bladder of adequate capacity to be able to do this, to be able to mobilize the bladder. And of course, there's some unusual situations. For example, if the bladder is small, like we saw in the previous IVP, a small bladder because of TB or radiotherapy, and the bladder cannot be mobilized, then the other alternative is to join the injured ureter to the opposite ureter. And that's called a transurethrourethrostomy. You join the ureter back to the other ureter because you cannot mobilize the bladder to overcome the defect. Sometimes you get injuries to both ureters are injured, so you have to fashion a double body flap. You have to fashion the bladder so you get two kind of horns coming up which can be used to anastomose the ureter. And sometimes the patient is unstable, or you don't have the expertise to do all this reconstructive repair in your op, you can always use a salvage procedure. And this is called ureteric exteriorization. You tie a simple feeding tube to the end of the ureter which has been damaged, and you bring the tube up through the abdominal wall. And then you can send the patient off the next day to a center where they can do this repair. The other aspect of secondary prevention is adequate training. For instance, in the University of Western Australia, Perth, they run this workshop. It's a two-day workshop for gynecologists, and it's called the Anatomy of Complication Workshop. And as you can see here, their next session is September of next year. And this workshop is running. I think their sponsors are Covidian, so probably you can ask your Covidian representatives about this. So at this workshop, the participants are required to do cadaveric dissections. That means you have to do cadaveric dissections on the ureter and the bladder and everything. And the next day, you can perform procedures, live surgery on sheep, where they teach you how to do urinary reimplants, how to manage bowel injury, muscular injury. So this kind of workshops are good to attend. Now we come to tertiary prevention. Tertiary prevention means early detection and management of delayed injuries. And unfortunately, we know more than two-thirds of all these urological injuries are only detected late. And because they're detected late, it results in a higher incidence of complications, need for multiple reparative procedures, higher incidence of renal loss, and higher incidence of medical litigation. So the important elements of tertiary prevention is post-op care, which must be supervised by senior staff. Because senior staff have a higher index of suspicion when patients tell you, I'm leaking urine. They have a lower threshold for early imaging. And because they're senior staff, they have the authority to quickly assemble a multidisciplinary team. That means, you know, the MO calls the urologist, you know, the surgeon calls, the gynecologist calls the urologist, and I think we've got a problem here. So he's able to quickly assemble this multidisciplinary team. Risk management should not be left to the junior member of the team. The senior management must be responsible to apologize, to explain, to initiate remedial action, provide support to the patient, and ensure complete documentation, because all of these are medical legal issues. And from the patient's point of view, she wants an explanation of what happened and what are you going to do to fix the problem. She wants an accountability from the surgeon and his team, and usually some form of compensation. So the clinical signs which would alert you to the fact that she's got a delayed urological injury, some of the clinical signs would be post-op pain, ileus, fever, hematuria, decreased urine output, urinary ascites, a urinoma, like you can see on the x-ray here, there's a huge urinoma. You know, the contrast from the right kidney, which is damaged because it's hypernephrotic, the contrast is now leaked into this huge cystic swelling, and that's a urinoma. Urine leak from the drain or from the vagina. These are early signs. Recurrent UTI or non-functioning kidneys, these are usually late presentations. In terms of investigations, raise serum creatinine, because the urine which leaks to the abdomen is absorbed, and therefore leading to a higher serum creatinine. A raised creatinine of any fluid coming out from the drain or from the vagina, it's got a very high creatinine level. This is almost pathognomonic of a leak. If you suspect this, then you have to carry out investigations to delineate both ureters and the bladder. And the standard has always been something to look at the upper tracts in terms of an IVU, and something to look at the lower tract in terms of a cystogram. So usually this combination, IVU and cystogram combination. In some centers, this has been replaced by a CT urogram. And you get very nice pictures, as you can see from here. They digitally subtract all the soft tissue, so you can see the ureter coming down, there's a leak here, the bladder here. But this requires a radiological team who is competent in doing this. If you don't have such facilities, I think it's just better to stick to the stock standard IVU and cystogram. And after these two investigations, usually you'd have to do a cystoscopy and a retrograde pyrogram. Retrograde pyrogram, this is to confirm what you suspected, what you found on the CT scan on the IVP. And also during the RPG, we can sometimes insert a stent inside. Insert a stent through the injured ureter, and therefore you don't have to go back in and again repair it. Management of delayed injuries. Nowadays, endourological stenting is the first choice for any kind of ureteric pathology.